Okay, so we will continue with memory management of the operating systems, and we have covered almost half of the topic last week, and today I will finish it with the virtual memory stuff. So we started with the memory management general idea, then we have talked about putting a process to the main memory as a whole package, which is called contiguous allocation or continuous allocation. We have seen problems with it, like the need for fragmentation. And then we decided to use the paging idea for the execution of processes. We eventually need to put them into memory, but it turns out that we don't have to put them into memory consecutively as one block. We can separate them into little pages and put them into page frames in the main memory. So we separate the logical address space of the process into pages, like these ones. This is the logical memory. And then we use a structure called page table that is basically showing us the mapping from the page to the page frame in the physical memory. So notice that this is the logical memory, this is the physical memory. Or we also interchangeably call this logical address space versus physical address space. So in this example, for instance, page 2 maps to frame 3, which is here. So yes, we see that here. So this is the paging idea that allows us to utilize memory better than the contiguous allocation idea. Then we have seen the mappings from the logical space to the physical space, etc. Then yeah, so using we have seen how to use the page table to make that conversion. We then realized that putting a one-dimensional page table, actually before that, apparently we have talked something else, which is the TLB, the translation look-aside buffer. So this is about reusing the page-to-page frame mappings, most recent ones, from cache memory, which is a limited amount of memory compared to the main memory, but it is very fast to access, again, compared to the real main memory. So we have seen the benefit of using TLB, which is here. So if we find that mapping in this cache little memory, then we will directly use it in the case of hits. Otherwise, in the case of a miss, we do the traditional thing, which is going to the memory to access the page table, the real table, not the cached version. And again, cached version is just a small portion of this. That's why we have these two separate things. Yeah, so in case of miss, we get the value from the page table in the main memory. So we make one additional memory access just to know this mapping. And then we do another memory access to get the instruction from that memory, from the main memory. And it turns out that so we have analyzed the memory access time, the total time, the effective access time, which is a combination of hits and misses. So we have discussed them. And we have talked about sharing pages. Because mostly we have multiple instances of the same process, like you have three Word documents open in front of you. And most of the code of that process, actually, the whole code is the same throughout the whole processes. The only changing part is the data part. So then we basically share the pages that are storing the code and other data, the specific data, So we share those three pages along these three processes, and we only use separate pages for the different data, like the text written on a given text editor, which is different from process to process, obviously. In some process, you are writing a recommendation letter. In another one, you are writing an exam, for instance. That's why we need separate stuff for that kind of private parts. But in general, we have seen the benefit of sharing pages. Then what we did, and finally, we did the following. We realized that holding a page table with every process is costly. Especially holding a one-dimensional page table is costly. It turns out that we use about 4 megabytes per process. If that process is using 4 gigabytes of logical memory, which is like common with video games, etc. So this annoys us a little bit. So this is, after all, a bookkeeping information. It doesn't contribute to the program directly. So we have talked about efficient structures to hold this page table, not with a 1D array, but with probably an array of arrays, or a hierarchical structure. And we have also seen the hashed version of it. So if you recall, instead of using only one page table, we just use the outer page table with pages to other page tables. So in the second level, we have the actual page table. But the trick is, among all these page tables, we only keep the currently accessed one in the main memory, and the others are written to disk, so waiting in the disk. So we are not wasting main memory space for those portions. But the outer table is always in the main memory, because after all, this will point us to the correct page table. And if it is not in the memory currently, then we read it from the disk, and now it is in the memory. So that was the idea. With that, we have reduced. So see, outer page table gets us the correct real page table, from where I get the frame ID for the logical address to physical address space conversion. And so with this hierarchical tactic, even with two-dimensional, so just two stages, we have seen that we only need 24 kilobytes per process instead of 4 megabytes per process. So this is like in the order of thousands, we save space, which was very impressive. Then we talked about using more dimensions, because this outer page table is always in the memory, so we should better keep that value low. Then we even realized that more dimensions will save us, will not really save us with big logical address spaces. So we then suggested the hashed page tables, where you basically essentially map the page number to a reasonable range, like from 0 to 1K, which is a hash table here. And obviously there will be collisions, but from your hash table knowledge, from the data structures course, we know how to handle them, like linear probing or separate chaining, etc. So we handle that. And now, given the correct entry, we now get the frame number. So we have covered them, Eklo. This was a crash tutorial, extremely fast tutorial of the 3 hours of work of the previous week in just 10 minutes. And now, for the rest of the class, I will slow it a little bit, obviously, and talk about the virtual memory, which builds on the information we have learned so far. So what is a virtual memory then? It is the utilization of the memory management techniques to implement a concept called virtual memory, which allows you to execute programs, processes whose size is bigger than the actual physical memory size. And for the memory management techniques, we have seen two of them actually, the paging technique and the contiguous allocation technique. We just skipped the contiguous allocation technique. It doesn't apply here. It is not a very good technique anyway. So we will basically utilize the paging idea to implement the virtual memory concept. And so remember, given a process, it has its own logical memory, which is a consecutive sets of addresses. Like you have an array, you have in your process, it just goes to the data part, heap part of the logical address space. But after all, it is a consecutive one block of space. And I want to map it to the physical memory smartly and carefully, so that even if the logical memory size is bigger than the existing physical memory size, I will still be able to execute that process. And the idea to do that is bringing a small portion of the program into the memory initially. Small portion is the keyword here. And then bring the rest whenever that part is needed. But the operating system, in order to avoid over-allocation, it just reserves you only a finite element, amount of frames, like the places to use. So you will use a small portion of the program to use only those allocated slots for you. That's why sometimes those slots will be full. So you have to unbring or remove some of the old pages or unused pages. So we will see algorithms to find them, those pages. So we will kick them out and we will replace them with the new pages of your current program. Yeah, so this is the idea. And as I said in the first item, initially we bring the part that includes the main, because it is your entrance point for all your processes. And then the page that includes the main function, if it doesn't fit into one page, then maybe you bring two pages for that. And then when you make a reference to a different location, like maybe you call a function which is arbitrarily located, so then you have to get the page that includes that function, the instructions of that function. So going to memory is essentially getting the instruction, right? Because after all, this is the instruction is going to be brought to the CPU and it will be executed in the CPU. If it needs some memory accesses, like the current instruction is about loading stuff into an array or updating an array or a binary tree, whatever, a memory location, then you also make other memory accesses. So with the virtual memory concept, we will be executing many programs, multiple programs in parallel. Pseudo parallel, because assuming you have a single CPU, at a given time only one of those memory processes are being executed. But as we have studied, context switches give the processes the illusion that they have their own CPU, hence they kind of work in parallel. We called it pseudo parallel. Yeah, but as far as the memory stuff goes for that multiple program execution, it is made possible now with the virtual memory, because I don't have to put all the content of a given process into the main memory. Then you will fill your whole memory with two or three processes, right? Assume you have a video game, you instantly filled the 4 gigabytes of your memory and you have like 8 gigabytes. So in that scenario, you can only use two video games given session. But this is not the case, as you know from your experience. We will bring only part of the program process to memory using this virtual memory concept. Here is the case where I have a virtual memory. So this is only for one process. Apparently this process has n pages. Okay, so I give you the size of the process in terms of page numbers, okay, not in terms of bytes. So this is easier to manage then. I have n pages for a given process, which means I have a page table mapping each of these pages to a page frame. But now look at the physical memory. In the physical memory, I have only 6 available slots. And we assume that size of a page is equal to the size of the frame. In general, frame size is bigger, but let's reduce complication. So assume we have the same size in the page and in the frame parts. So currently, obviously, this physical memory of 6 slots is not able to hold all these n slots. But luckily, using the virtual memory, I will be only using 4 pages of this process at a given time. And all other pages are sitting on the disk. So after all, your program, the set of instructions of it, must sit on the disk, right? You should accommodate it there constantly, permanently. And when I need the current instruction and probably the next guesses, so I want to reduce this going to disk, getting to page, and going to disk, getting to page to memory iterations. I want to reduce them. That's why I hold multiple pages, not only one page of a given process. So in this example, the first 4 pages are loaded, as you can see, 0, 1, 2, 3, which are these 4 pages, page 0, 1, 2, 3. And like page 3 maps to 0, 1, 2, frame 2, for instance. Yeah, so now let me be more clear on the logical address space. So this box, okay, so these pages, n pages, but if you look more carefully, so what are these pages holding? So as I mentioned, they definitely hold the code, the set of instructions that make up that process. You also have some global variables that you know at the compile time. So then once you compile that program, you know that you will access them, so that data is fixed and it is also loaded into the logical or virtual address space of this process. Then comes another data storage part, which is a heap, and this is different from the global variable stuff. This is the dynamic part. So at the compile time, you don't know how much memory you will allocate for that structure. So you will probably call a malloc in C or new in C++. But inside the brackets, you will use some numbers, like give me that amount of floats or doubles or whatever, complex numbers. So since you don't know that, you just keep this part dynamic. So you reserve a slot within your memory space, logical space, and as you do mallocs, this heap shrinks, grows, and as you do free or deletes, like don't use it anymore, then it shrinks. So moral of the story is this part grows and shrinks, but after all, it will stay inside your logical address space. And the fourth and other component of your logical address space is this stack, which is like the runtime stack. It is used for function calls, because one function calls another. So A calls B, B calls C. And when C finishes, you need to go back to B, not to A. So you need to go back to the most recent one. And then it is very logical to use a stack here, as you know from your data structure class, last in first out. So once you are done with the function C, you know your return address, which is the top of the stack. But not only the return addresses, we also store in this stack the local variables for that function. Again, decided during the runtime, not the compile time. Also, some parameters. Sometimes parameters are required for functions. So you store them as well. And then you also, what else? Yeah, so these are the essentials: function parameters, local variables, return addresses. This part makes up the stack part of your logical space. And we also have the dynamically growing and shrinking heap part. We also have the fixed global variable data part and the fixed instructions part. So they don't change, obviously. Once you have a program, it doesn't generate a new code. It is just weird. So these are the static, stable components of your logical address space. So now that, and who sets it up? A compiler requests this memory, and operating system grants it. Okay, so this is the logical space. And now coming back to the virtual memory, we will implement it using something called demand paging. Again, this is the paging idea, but it will be based on demands. So, what is that? What does it mean? It means that bring pages into memory when they are used. Okay, only when they are used. So this will require you to use less memory for a given process. And also, since the rest of the pages of this space, logical space, is in the disk, there will be some I/O going to disk, coming back from disk. So we will keep it as few as possible with some smart algorithms. You can now support more users, more processes. Since you have only a small amount of memory allocated for them, now you can use many different independent processes in your little physical memory. Okay, so assume that you need a page. You are in the main function. You call another function which is far away from you, so you need that page. So you make a reference. The reference can be invalid, by the way. So for instance, let's forget about the function call, but let's assume that you want to access some index of an array. So because since array is in memory, you will make a memory reference. But if that reference is like minus a negative number, then you will abort because you don't know how to handle it. So that number is beyond your logical address space. So this is the invalid reference case, in which case you do nothing. You just abort because you can't execute further. Your program finishes there. And this is something you have seen with your segmentation faults in your experience, I believe. So this is the abort case. But sometimes when you reference a page, this may naturally happen. Don't worry. So this is the case I talked about in the beginning. You are currently in the page that holds the main function, and from that function you call another function which is far away from you. So you maybe in it is in page 17, but the page 17 is not in memory. You referenced it, but it is not in the memory. Then operating system kicks in and it makes the arrangements so that it brings it back from disk to the memory. So this is quite natural. Obviously, if you do it a lot of times, then it will affect the performance, the execution time of this process. So you need to keep it low, but still this is natural. It can happen and it will happen. Actually, it is what we will see as page replacements later. So this lazy swapper is about this idea, actually, the ideas we are talking about from the beginning. You bring a page into memory from disk only when it is needed. Okay, don't just bring it for fun. So this swapper is also known as pager, but these are not very important terms. So the concept here is important, and it is that you bring a page into memory from disk only when it is needed. So in memory means, memory is a set of frames, as we discussed before. So a page is in the second frame maybe, or first frame. And in addition to the frame number, we also maintain a validity bit here. So what does it tell us? It tells us that there is a page fault, so I can't find the corresponding frame number for a given page. It is either not even existing here, or it has this I invalid attached to it. So it means that it is not valid anymore. So then we need to bring it into memory. So in the previous example, for instance, I guess I am making a flashback here. Page 2 is in memory, but page n minus 1 isn't. So this is a snapshot of your system at a given time, where we have a process consisting of 8 pages, okay, and I just use only 3 pages of it. So in my precious physical memory, I decide to reserve only 3 slots for this whole process, and currently A is in the main memory, also C, also F. Notice that A, C, and F, they are also in the disk, because after all they are part of my process that comes as a package. But in addition to them, I also have the missing pieces in the disk at all times. So all pages are in the disk at all times. So what is happening? Let's analyze this example. Instructions in page 0. Okay, so I am here, A. So I am here, basically, somewhere here in this gray box. So it calls a function, or even simpler, it uses an operand, like a variable, that is stored at a different page. So it is making a reference to an array. But it is a very long array, so it didn't fit into this page. So I am going to look at page 4, okay? So for the page 4, which is E, I look at the 4 here, which it corresponds to page 4, this index 4 and this 4. But here I see an invalid bit. So then I don't even care what is written here. Invalid means 4 isn't in the physical memory. So there is a page fault. This is called a page fault. I can't find the frame for a given page. I can't find the valid frame for a given page. So what you do is you suspend the program, don't terminate it because this is natural, it can happen, but you let it go out of the CPU because currently I can't let it function. So you suspend it and schedule another program. And during this suspension, I still do some work for this process. What is that work? In the background, operating system talks with the disk to bring the fourth page, which is E. Okay, it looks and finds this E in the disk, and it also decides which of these three to remove, because remember I only have three places to work with. It will probably not remove A because A is currently active, so it is likely to be active again. So it will remove maybe C or F, and it will put E here instead of F. So if it is here, then frame nine, I will put into index 4, I will write 9 here, and I will make this bit V valid. This is the process. This is the idea. So page fault is then, it is the scenario where I can't find the page in memory. This is called a page fault. When is it triggered? Your CPU is executing one of your instructions, and that instruction is making an access to a different page that is not in the physical memory. Like as we discussed, it can be so CPU computed an index for you for a given array, and that index is far away from where I am currently at. So then it is a triggering. It is triggering the page fault because that page isn't in the physical memory currently. I will go get it at some point. Not me, the operating system will do it for us. But you will leave the CPU at that time because currently you are not able to satisfy that instruction. Second scenario is you want to get the instruction. Okay, so assume that inside your page you have a page size of 4 kilobytes, which makes 4096 bytes. Okay, and assume each byte is an instruction. Okay, so like each byte is an instruction. Okay, so it's not so realistic, but anyway, so you are at instruction 4096. You execute it. There is no reference to another page, so it is a local instruction. Like maybe it is the current instruction is an if condition. It is testing one variable, one register versus another register. Is it less than the other one, for instance? Now the next instruction is instruction 4097. So it is not in that page, right? Because that page holds only 4096 instructions. So naturally, in the next step, I don't do any function call. I am still in the next instruction, which is 4097. But due to the size limit of the page, I don't have the next page. So I will get that page containing the next instruction from the disk and put it into the physical memory. So, but the story is there has been a page fault at that time. When I have finished executing the instruction number 4096, I did it, but when I want to do 4097, I have experienced a page fault and I suspend, leave the CPU, and the operating system talks with the disk and gets that next page. And by saying that operating system talks with the disk, actually now the kernel code, the operating system code is in the CPU, okay? So I suspend the process, leaves the CPU, and the related part of the kernel space, kernel code, comes into the CPU to do something for that process. So implicitly, CPU is still working for you, actually. But to be more exact, you are not in the CPU now. The operating system code is in the CPU. It is trying to talk with the disk using its own sets of hardware instructions. And it talks with the disk to get the next page. Yeah. And how to handle a page fault then? So we have seen that it can be triggered by executing an instruction during the execution due to a memory access, or to get the next instruction. Two cases. How to handle? Get an empty frame to load the new page into. Okay, so talk with the disk, make a disk IO, load the page from disk to that empty frame or victim frame. Then you need to update your page table, because now I have a new page, like page 4, and it is using frame 7. So you go to your page table and set this entry 4 to 7, and also set this bit to V, valid. And then what you do is, now you are back in business, back in CPU, but that instruction, assuming this first scenario, it needs to restart. It is not a big deal because it is one single instruction, so you restart it. And in this case, then you haven't even started this instruction, you just suspend. Now that you have the instruction, you restart that instruction. So in that case, we should call it start, actually. But anyway, it is clear, I guess. Yes, and the visual diagram of those words is here. So what we have here is, I am here in the CPU. Okay, so this is the CPU apparently. So this current instruction wants to load M. So it wants to load something. Maybe it's an array-based instruction. So it will load something from memory to that operand. Okay, so that load M requires you to go to a particular page, okay? So for that page, I want to learn the frame, the physical frame number for that page. But since it is invalid, okay, I suspend, so I produce a trap. So then operating system kicks in. And it goes to the disk or a backing store. In general, it's a disk. So it locates it, and then its operating system, again, given this content, it brings in this missing page from disk to this index, index 012, index 2. Then I write 2 here and make it valid V. And also, obviously, it is not the only point to update the table. I also give that information to the CPU back in the sixth step. How to do that? I restart that instruction, but now I have the mapping, which is M is page 13 in frame 2. So when I restart that instruction, I don't go over this path. I just go from here to index 2, so 012. I come here and read the content from here, which is already brought from disk. So what is the effective access time to memory during this step? So let me talk about them and stop for this session. So what you do? Let's suppose that P represents the page fault rate. It's the probability between 0 and 1. 0 probability means there is no page fault. It means what? It means I certainly get what I want from the physical memory. I never go and do the swapping between disk and memory. And 1 means a bad scenario where I constantly, everywhere reference is a fault. So I can't find what I want in the memory, so I go to disk at all times. So let's use a continuous variable P to represent these scenarios. So 1 minus P times memory access. So you will definitely make a memory access. So even if there is no page fault, so when P is 0, then you go to memory here. From here, you go to here directly. You don't do the above. But you have to go to memory at some point because the instruction is here. Okay, so you definitely make 1 memory access, then P is 0, 1 minus 0 is 1. And I skip all these cases because P is 0. But in general, what you do is sometimes I don't suffer from fault, so I do memory access, but sometimes with P rate, I have a problem. What is that problem? I have to go and swap the page out, the victim page, like this page is written back to disk. It is not shown here, but because as I shown here, I guess, yeah, you need to, if victim is F, you need to write it back to disk and allocate this space for the new M. Anyway, then swap the page in and also restart the instruction. There is also this page fault overhead. This is also involved. What is that? It is about these steps, okay? Like creating the trap, loading the kernel code to the CPU. These are all overheads. It is not directly contributing to the progress of your process. So let's see this with an actual example to convince you, to make you understand better the scenario. So this is the equation we end up with. So how does it apply in real world? Memory access is a very fast action, okay? It is like 200 nanoseconds. And an average page fault service time, which is this set of all these 4 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, and they involve disk access. That's why it is much bigger. It is 8, but it is 8 milliseconds. So what is the conversion between millisecond and nanosecond? 1 millisecond is 1 million nanoseconds. If I recall correctly, yes. So you need to put 6 zeros here, actually. So this is like 8 million nanoseconds versus 200 nanoseconds. So 8 million here, 200 here. Then what is happening is 1 minus P rate, with that rate, there is no fault. I do 200 seconds, but P rate, the page fault rate, I do 8 million nanoseconds. So if you open this, I have 200 times P times something, like 8 million. Now let's visualize this better by putting a value for P between 0 and 1. So let's say that only 1/1000, okay? So for every 1000 instruction, I experience a page fault, which looks good, right? So you don't have any problem for 1000, and then you have a problem. So it is not very frequent, which is nice. But still, even with that BT, what you end up with is, if you plug 1000 here, you get rid of 3 zeros here. So you have, I think, 8000 instead of 8 million. 8000 plus to 8200 nanoseconds, which makes 8.2 microseconds. So the conversion between nanosecond and microsecond is 1000 microsecond is 1 nanosecond. So we are also studying that unnecessary conversions here, but anyway, so you have an 8.2 microseconds, okay, even with 1/1000 page fault rate. This is slow actually, because with zero page fault, I have just 200 nanoseconds. But now I have 8200 nanoseconds. So if you divide them, divide one with the other, you see that 200 is 40 times smaller than, almost 40 times smaller than 8200. So it means that you have a slowdown by a factor of 40 by just experiencing 1/1000 page faults. Yeah, so this is again something to think about, right? You have page faults very rarely, not very rarely, but rarely, infrequently, like it happens after 1000 steps. And even in that scenario, your process execution slows down 40 times. Yeah, okay, so I think this is enough for the current session. I will come back in 10 minutes, like 13:40, and I will see you then.